I've come to the deep south of USA to talk to a guy who is obsessed with chickens, or more specifically, chicken nuggets. Hi.
Well, hello.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you, Laura.
Raj Patel is a British activist, academic, and writer on a quest to tackle poverty and famine.
Why is the chicken nugget the symbol of our modern times for you?
If there's going to be any intelligent life after humans, they will look in the fossil record, and what are they going to see? They're going to see plastic, they're going to see radiation from atmospheric weapons tests, and they're going to see trillions of chicken bones. And those chicken bones don't get there by magic. They get there because of capitalism.
Perhaps the one thing that Raj is obsessed with more than chickens is capitalism. It's taken him from working inside the global halls of power to fighting against them on the streets. And the obsession started when he was just 5 years old on a family holiday in India.
I remember being in a monsoon and there was, at a traffic light, a girl, she can't have been more than 12, and she was swaying backwards and forwards, saying, please, we're hungry, we're wet, we don't have any money, please, can you give us some money? There was a kid in her arms who was screaming and screaming and screaming, and in the end, I was screaming and screaming and screaming, trying to figure out, well, why is she out there? Why doesn't she have money, and why do we have money? And, you know, in the end, my parents sort of cranked down the window a little bit and you know, sort of shoved some money out, and then we sped off into the night. But I couldn't stop thinking about her, and I can't stop thinking about her. When I came back home, I started renting out my toys at kindergarten so that we could send money for hunger relief.
How much money did you end up raising?
Well, it can't have been more than £5, but, you know, it was £5!
You have worked at the World Bank, the World Trade Organization, United Nations. What was the most important thing you learned from being inside these, you know, behemoths? Organizations.
What I found in these institutions was not an evil guy in a leather chair stroking a white cat, but the people who are inside them aren't particularly malicious, but they are both products and participants of a system that is making us head in the wrong direction. At the World Trade Organization, it was very easy to see whose expertise was being relied on. So when you know, the man from Motorola came by and offered trade analysis, that went to the top of the pile, whereas when the person from Friends of the Earth came, that went straight into the trash can. Because we looked to these organizations for ideas of impartial analysis and truth, and in fact, nothing could be further from the truth.
Discovering that bodies like the UN and the World Trade Organization didn't hold the solution to ending poverty led Raj to another discovery.
I discovered tear gas, and that was with thousands of other people for things like the World Trade Organization protests in Seattle in 1999. I'm lucky compared to some of my colleagues who were caught and arrested and beaten.
No, I'm sorry, I can't really talk, but I can. The tear gas is really powerful.
For me, I was a double agent. I was one of many thousands of people on the streets, but I was also part of the Zimbabwean delegation, you know, being part of those protests and spreading the word about what it was that was happening inside and then running back inside and going back and forth.
The market speaks by hiding prices, hiding the real cost.
They hide them from me.
How did you first find out that there's a group of people out there that are convinced that you're the Messiah?
I was on the Colbert Report the day after I got a series of messages asking, are you the Maitreya? And so I looked it up. I found out that there was a prophecy. A man born in the same year I was born in, who traveled from India to London the same year as I did, who worked in the East End fighting hunger, going to be on American television when the stars were in a certain position, that person would be the Maitreya. The thing they don't tell you when you're made the Messiah is that there are a bunch of people who also think that you're the Antichrist and want to kill you. And so I had a fair bit of that as well.
Is that something that's still following you around today at all, that experience, you know, 10 years later?
Oh, yeah. My students routinely mock me about it. And, you know, occasionally I grant a couple of wishes.
It stops people who are grappling with this problem from being able to be agents of change.
What kind of advice would you give to a young person who wants to get involved in activism?
One of the ways that we've been taught that we can make change, particularly in America, is by shopping smarter. You know, if only you buy organic and fair trade, everything's going to be fine. And that's just not enough. And the ultimate activist question is this: who do you love? Tell me who you love. I love my grandma, I love my auntie, I love my uncle. Okay, now how are they doing? They're fine. Are they really doing fine? Well, no, they're struggling, you know. And in that conversation, you've started with a conversation about love, but you move towards conversations about structural racism, about hunger, about poverty. And what, you know, what's always been true about activism and social change is that if you start from a place of love rather than a place of what policy issue must we tackle next, love is the rocket fuel that you need to be able to get you through, particularly if you are organized together.
So that's how a British academic ends up on a chicken farm in Texas, wearing a suit on a 40-degree day and plotting to bring down capitalism. So how do chickens come into this again?
Capitalism is always on the hunt for cheap things. And the nugget is sort of an embodiment of seven cheap things.
Raj believes that nature, money, work, care, lives, and energy have all been cheapened to create our current society. And this. But the final ingredient to making cheap chicken? Cheap food.
And that's an irony, right? You need cheap food to make cheap food. In order for workers to be paid very little, their food needs to consume a very small amount of their wages. And in the United States, we spend less than 10% of our annual sort of household income on food.
So that's all the seven cheap things you need to make this chicken. Are we going to eat any?
Well, no, this chuck's not for me. I'm vegetarian, so I'm going to have some bread.